Good morning. What a privilege it is to be able to teach to you guys from God's Word this morning. Thank you so much for being here. And you guys probably already have your Bibles open to Psalm 128. I was supposed to tell you to open your Bibles to Psalm 128, and I was going to tell you a story while you did that. But that's okay. I can tell you the story now. You all know the man by the name Martin Luther. Well, there's a story about Martin Luther that once upon a time, he was in the middle of nowhere, and he got caught into a thunderstorm, and lightning was crashing down around him. If you've ever been in a thunderstorm where the lightning is right by you, it is a fearful thing, right? And it just shakes your heart, and it causes terror within you. But the thing that was most scary for Martin Luther was that he thought God was going to strike him down with a lightning bolt and kill him and send him straight to hell. What a terrifying thing to be in the middle of, amen? And so he pleaded with God, God, don't kill me, God, don't kill me. I'll become a monk, I'll become a monk, I'll become a monk. And he was just gripped with fear. And he got out of the thunderstorm and he did just that. He ran off to become a monk. He ran right to the monastery. So here's an example of a man who feared God, but did he fear God as we ought to fear God? That's the question. Well, our passage this morning is about the fear of the Lord and the blessings that the fear of the Lord produces in our lives. When I fear God, my life will be blessed, and the lives of others around me will be blessed. God's favor will be upon me. There will be fruit in my life. And so the title of this message is the fearfully blessed life. We're going to jump right in. Point number one, the fear of the Lord in my life. Actually, let's say a word of prayer first. Father, what an important message for us all this morning, to learn to fear you, God. And Lord, that the blessings that you desire for us would come out of that, oh God. May it be so. And so, Lord, help me now to share the words that you have helped me to prepare for us this morning. And may we all walk away this morning with a sense of reverence and awe and fear and love and joy. May our hearts be flooded with emotions that bring you glory this morning. And may it change the way we live our lives. In Jesus' name, amen. Number one, the fear of the Lord in my life. Let's see this in Psalm 128. Blessed is everyone who fears the Lord, who walks in his ways. You shall eat the fruit of the labor of your hands. You shall be blessed, and it shall be well with you. Your wife will be like a fruitful vine within your house. Your children will be like olive shoots around your table. Behold, thus shall the man be blessed who fears the Lord. The Lord bless you from Zion. May you see the prosperity of Jerusalem all the days of your life. May you see your children's children. Peace be upon Israel. So did you see that in verses 1 through 4? The fear of the Lord. That's what this passage is about. That's the primary message of this passage. The fear of the Lord and what it produces in our lives. The blessing that it produces in our lives. But what does it mean to fear the Lord? I mean, we speak of fear in a lot of different ways, don't we? Martin Luther was afraid of God in a certain kind of way. There's other ways we fear. I'm afraid of falling off of a bridge. I'm afraid of twisting my ankle if I step off this stage here. Those are different kinds of fears, right? I'm afraid that my kids won't do their homework. When I'm in Cubs Stadium in Wrigley Field and there's a home run hit and everybody gets up and shouts, we're fearful. We're fearful. So the Bible speaks of fear in a sense of trembling and awe and reverence. And these are all different words that we use to describe fear. But we're oftentimes misunderstood about this word fear, and it's because we have such an aversion to fear, don't we? We're afraid of fear. Our culture is fear-stricken. We're afraid of everything. And the problem is not that we have faith in God. This is exactly what Bertrand Russell, he was an atheist philosopher 100 years ago. This is what he said. He said, the reason why we're so fearful in our culture is because we have faith in God. It's because we have religion in our culture, and that creates fear. And so 100 years later, we've pushed God out more than ever before, and yet we're more fearful than ever before. And we've got safety nets for everything. We worship safety. We've got seatbelts and airbags. We put little things in the top of our coffee cups because we're afraid we might spill coffee on ourselves. We bubble wrap our kids and send them off to school. We helicopter parent them. We're fearful of everything. So we've pushed God out of our culture. We've got more safety now than ever before, and yet we're more fearful than ever before. Why is that? Well, Jesus said the exact opposite of what Bertrand Russell said. Jesus said to his disciples, the reason that they were afraid is because of their lack of faith. And I want to argue this morning that lack of faith is another way of saying lack of the fear of the Lord. Okay? So it's not the removal of fears, or it's not the removal of the fear of the Lord that's going to remove our fears. It is the fear of the Lord. It's the healthy fear of the Lord. John Newton said it this way in Amazing Grace, his famous hymn. He said, 'Twas grace that taught my heart to fear. Grace taught me to fear. And grace my fears relieved.' So there's a good kind of fear that grace teaches us how to fear in that way. And there's a bad kind of fear that grace relieves. Which brings up the question, is fear the right word to use? I mean, we like to replace the word fear with reverence or awe, and those are good words, but the problem is that no word fully captures this idea. We really have to look at examples of it, and so we're going to spend quite a bit of time up front in this message just looking at passages about the fear of the Lord and the many different ways it's used in Scripture. So, first passage, Exodus chapter 20, verse 20. There's a kind of fear that we are to avoid, and there's a kind of fear that we're to pursue. Listen to this verse. Do not fear, for God has come to test you, so that the fear of him may be before you, so that you may not sin. So there's a good kind of fear, and there's a bad kind of fear. A fear to pursue, and a fear to avoid. There's also a sinful kind of fear. In Revelation chapter 6, the people who are fleeing from the wrath of God, they hide themselves in caves, and they say, fall on us, rocks, fall on us, mountains. And they want to hide themselves from the judgment of the Lord and the wrath of the Lamb. That's a sinful kind of fear, isn't it? Remember Martin Luther, sadly, when he ran from God, he ran straight to the monastery. And this is what he says about the fear of the Lord that he was taught there. He says, Christ was depicted as a grim tyrant, a furious and stern judge. Do you see God that way this morning? Who demanded much of us, a stern judge who demanded much of us and imposed good works as payment for our sins. I did not love, yes, I hated the righteous God who punishes sinners, and secretly, if not blasphemously, I was angry with God. This is the type of fear that people can have of God, but it's a sinful kind of fear. It's a fear that makes us run away from God and not towards God. The fear of the Lord should cause us to fall towards him and not away from him. Well, fear also is described in Scripture with emotions. There's lots of different emotions that are described with fear. And actually, the word fear is closely related in the Bible to love and to joy. In Deuteronomy chapter 6, verse 5, we read, "You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your might." But two verses before that, he says, I'm giving to you these commandments and these statutes and these judgments so that you may fear the Lord. Remember the women who went to the empty tomb and they walked away, and it says that they went away with fear and joy. So there's a wide range of emotions when we're talking about the fear of the Lord. Kind of like there's a wide range of emotions. Have you ever been at the Grand Canyon before? Forget about looking at a picture. That's nothing like actually standing there, and you're standing right on the edge and you're looking at this thing that is so big and so awesome, and you're just flooded with emotions. And there's no words that really, you can't explain it. It's big, it's awesome, it's fearful, it's wonderful. I mean, there's words just fall short. You just go, oh, and there's part of you that wants to go like this, and there's part of you that you just can't stop looking at it. You just stare at it, right? And so there's emotions that are stirred up when we fear the Lord. People fear God in Scripture when God has been exceedingly good towards them. Remember Jacob, when he has that dream in Genesis 28, and he sees this ladder to heaven, and the angels of God are ascending and descending. And in that dream, God speaks this word of blessing. There's not a single word, not a single word of evil towards Jacob. It's all good. I'm going to bless you. I'm going to bless your family. I'm going to do good for you, Jacob. It's all good. And this is what Jacob says when he wakes up. He says, "Surely the Lord is in this place, and I did not know it." And he was afraid and said, "How awesome is this place? This is none other than the house of God, and this is the gate of heaven." Now, what kind of fear did he have? Is he terror-stricken of God? No. And yet, we see here clearly that the goodness of God in Jacob's life caused him to fear. Also, there are physical responses that are associated with fear in Scripture, which is why probably the word reverence isn't the best word either, right? When I think of reverence, I don't know, for me, I think of somebody with, and, you know, with robes, and, you know, I think of, it just draws up different pictures in my mind than the fear and the trembling that God's word talks about in the fear of the Lord. Look at Jeremiah 33:9. "They shall fear and tremble because of all the good and the prosperity I provide." In Isaiah 60:5, "Then you shall see and be radiant. Your heart shall thrill." It's the same word for fear. Your heart shall thrill and exult. Earlier in Isaiah, one of the best examples of the fear of the Lord is in Isaiah 6, right? Isaiah, he has this vision of God, and the walls of the temple are shaking, and angels are covering their faces and their feet, and they're saying, "Holy, holy, holy." And he's caught up into this experience, and it causes him to fall on his face, and he says, "Woe is me. I'm a man of unclean lips. I dwell amongst the people of unclean lips." And he fears the Lord. And yet God cleanses him. And right after that, when God says, "Whom shall I send?" He says, "Here am I, here am I. Send me, send me." He was afraid, but it caused him to go towards God and towards God's mission, not run away from God the way that Luther did. John Bunyan calls this kind of experience, and all of you have experienced this, those of you who love God and fear God. He calls this kind of experience, I love this, blessed confusion. Blessed confusion, where you weep over your own sin and your own wickedness, and you weep at the grace and the mercy and the glory of God. Flood of emotions, confusing emotions, blessed confusion. Well, also there's a kind of fear that as Christians we need to avoid. And this is one of the key passages that people talk about when we talk about the fear of the Lord. But I want to listen, I want you to hear it, and I want you to hear it from a different perspective, perhaps, than what you know of it. This is 1 John 4:18. "There is no fear in love, but perfect love casts out fear. For fear has to do with punishment, and whoever fears has not been perfected in love." So this is a fear of punishment. And as Christians, we shouldn't have that kind of fear, because our punishment has been placed upon Jesus Christ, and we no longer have to fear judgment. But I also want to argue that those words, perfected in love, he says, whoever fears has not been perfected in love. I want to argue that those words, perfected in love, is almost another way of saying, fear the Lord. The one who fears punishment has not been perfected in the fear of the Lord, in a true love of God. Well, Charles Spurgeon, he spoke of lightning as well. He spoke of thunderstorms. And this is what he said about lightning and thunderstorms. He said, "I love the lightnings. God's thunder is my delight. I like to hear my heavenly Father's voice in the thunder." And he goes on to speak of the shame that he would oftentimes have if there was a thunderstorm and he was afraid to run out into it. He was actually ashamed of that. He's like, "No, I'm going to run out into the thunderstorm. I want to look up. I want to gaze into the window of heaven. I want to hear God's voice. I want to hear my heavenly Father." Totally different experience than what Martin Luther had. Martin Luther had not yet come to know Jesus as his Redeemer and his Father, and God as his Father. Well, what about this? If I were to ask you, why are you created? What is your purpose? I'm sure all of you would say, we are created to glorify God and to enjoy him forever. Or maybe you'd quote what Piper says, we are created to fear God by enjoying him forever. I love that. And that's right. It says in Isaiah 43, verse 7, that we were created for his glory. But what about this verse in Ecclesiastes 12, 13? This is written by Solomon. And Solomon, as you know, is the wisest philosopher who ever lived, aside from Jesus. And he basically spends this time in his life, a season in his life, searching and trying to find out what is our purpose? What is the meaning of life, right? And he says this at the very end of Ecclesiastes chapter 12, verse 13. He says, the end of the matter, all has been heard. Fear God and keep his commandments, for this is the whole duty of man. Do you hear that? The whole duty of man? What is the chief end of man? To glorify God and enjoyment? What's the whole duty of man? To fear God? They're saying the same thing. They're saying the same thing. The fear of the Lord is to glorify God, and to glorify God is to fear the Lord. This is the whole duty of man. We fear him, and we fall down towards, not away from him. We tremble before him. We gaze long and deep into him. Our emotions are flooded. There's great joy. There's great fear. Well, last passage. Jesus feared the Lord. The perfect, sinless Son of God feared God. In Isaiah chapter 11, verses 1 through 3, and the Spirit of the Lord shall rest upon him. The spirit of wisdom and understanding, the spirit of counsel and might, the spirit of knowledge and the fear of the Lord. And his delight shall be in the fear of the Lord. Well, you might be listening and saying, God, Brian, I don't know if I fear God in that way, right? I mean, our fear often fluctuates. I mean, do I tremble before God? Do I fear him as a son fears his father? Fearful that I might dishonor him? Am I in awe of him? Do I gaze long and hard upon him? In his word, in prayer, in community? How do we attain this? How do we attain this kind of fear of the Lord? Well, the good news is that the fear of the Lord is a gift that's given to us in Christ. Jeremiah chapter 32, verse 40. This is speaking of the new covenant. And God is speaking about a time when he says, I will put the fear of me in their hearts that they may not turn from me. I can't change my heart posture, and yet God commands my heart to have a certain kind of posture. I can't fear the Lord the way that Scripture describes it, not perfectly, definitely not in my own strength, and yet God commands me to fear him. And so this is a cause for us to plead with God, to go before him, to gaze deeply and say, God, give me this kind of fear for you. Paul David Tripp summarized the fear of the Lord in this way. He said, to fear God means that my life is structured by a sense of awe, worship, and obedience that flows out of recognizing him and his glory. He becomes the single most important reference point for all that I desire, think, do, and say. God is my motive, and God is my goal. The fear of God is meant to be the central organizing force in my life. Let's move on to point number two. The Lord's favor in my life. When we fear the Lord in a godly way, not in a sinful way, it produces God's favor in my life and in the lives of others around me. Another way of saying that is to say that the fear of God is the root, and godliness and wisdom and God's favor is the fruit of the root. So in this passage, I want you to see this. He moves from the fear of the Lord to the wisdom of the Lord, and they're spoken almost as identical, and yet the fear of the Lord is the root, and the wisdom of the Lord is the fruit. And the wisdom of the Lord then describes, or it points towards the blessings that's in this passage. So let's see that here in verse 1. It says, blessed is everyone who fears the Lord, who walks in his ways. Now here the psalmist is speaking of the straight path of wisdom versus the crooked path of foolishness. So fear and wisdom are closely related, but in Proverbs chapter 1 through 9, we see these two paths, the crooked path and the straight path. And the fear of the Lord is the beginning, or is the root of wisdom. We read that in Proverbs 9, verse 10. The fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. So we fear the Lord, and that produces wisdom. Our fear of God helps us in the decisions that we make. It gives us wisdom and planning because our path is surrendered to God. It's only when our heart is in a posture of fear towards the Lord that we begin to live wisely, because we see the world around us through the lens of God, His will, His ways, His desires. It's a path of wisdom. We walk in His ways. And it produces fruitfulness and blessing in our work and in our family and in the church. Another way of saying this, men, we've been talking about bigger God and better. Last month, Steve talked about bigger God, better prayer. That's right. When you fear the Lord, when you have a bigger vision of God, that will change your prayer life. When you have a bigger vision of God, it will change purity in your life. We're going to talk about that this month. So, the fear of the Lord produces a walking in His ways, a wisdom, a path of wisdom. And then that produces blessing in our work. Look at verse 2. The man who fears the Lord shall eat the fruit of the labor of your hands. So as he is now fearing the Lord and walking in His ways, his attitude changes towards labor. Hard work, which used to be a curse, becomes a blessing. And the fruit of his labor becomes a rich reward. We have to remember that work is something that God established before the fall. It's not a curse. And yet we speak about work as though it's a curse. We associate Monday with misery and Friday with fun. And surely the curse has made work difficult, but work itself is a blessing. We talked about High Five. A lot of us served in High Five, and boy, that was work. It was laborious. But there was such a sweet blessing as we saw these kids have just a blast. They were having fun. They were drawn closer to the Lord. We heard these kids just have conversations about God. I've never heard kids talk about God in this way before. It was amazing. So there was great, but I was tired. I was tired. At the end of the night, I laid on the bed. Lori put her hands on my feet like this, and I was out. I was just out. But I slept so sweet, and I woke up refreshed, and I was ready to go again. And there was just great fruit, and there was this joy because I was doing God's work. And so the fear of the Lord produces a wisdom, and that wisdom changes the way we work. It changes the way we eat. It changes the way we sleep, because we work as unto the Lord. And when we eat, we say, thank you, God. We recognize everything comes from Him. And when we sleep, we leave the fruit in His hands, like a farmer does. Because a farmer can till the ground and we can plant the seed, but God has to bring the rain and God has to cause the fruit to come, right? And so we leave it in God's hands. And so we sleep well because of the fear of the Lord. It changes the way we work. What about our family? The man who fears the Lord and walks in wisdom, his home will be blessed. Verse 3, he says, your wife will be like a fruitful vine within your house. Your children will be like olive shoots around your table. The man who fears the Lord and walks in his ways and is walking in wisdom, naturally, this is going to produce fruit in his home. And here the picture is a vine and an olive tree, which is basically just saying it's going to be fruitful. The home is fruitful. It's filled with joy and laughter. It's filled with zeal and love for God, because the man who leads the home fears the Lord. The table is set, and all who are gathered there are filled with joy and blessing. The children around the table are provided with an environment. Sorry, that's my phone. Note to self, turn off phone when you do message. Hopefully that doesn't happen again. They're sitting around the table and they grow because they're in an environment that's safe and it's secure and there's peace. It's free from judgment. They're not embarrassed to be themselves. There's no place like home. They're filled with joy, and so they can blossom. As the father and the mother fear the Lord, the children see that and they want to fear the Lord this way. They want to be caught up in this experience that God is doing in their mom and their dad. The husband nourishes and cherishes his wife. Cares for her in the same way he cares for his own body. He has a healthy fear of God, and that changes the way that he plays his part as Christ in the home. The woman is submissive to her husband because her husband's not this tyrant who is beating her down and keeping her under his thumb. He's a man who serves her and loves her and is sacrificial for her. This is what the fear of the Lord does in the family. When we make God big in our lives, God becomes big in our home. It's as simple as that. And marriage is meant to be a picture of the gospel. And so people see the marriage and then they're wrapped up and swept up into the fear of the Lord as well. So it blesses the family. Well, furthermore, in verses 5 through 6, we see here that the believing community is blessed. And here in these verses, we see a priestly blessing. It's given for the community, for those who collectively fear the Lord. Today, we could represent this with the church, right? It's an atmosphere, it's meant to be, an atmosphere of peace and prosperity. The blessing of God that's upon the community is there because each individual family is fearing the Lord. And the blessing then is passed on to your children's children. You see that in verse 6 here. There's a spiritual heritage of the gospel that's passed down generationally. The aroma of the fear of God is in the church because the aroma of the fear of God is in the home, because the aroma of the fear of God is in the individual's life. And together, we look forward and hope to the day when we will see Christ in his kingdom, where God will bless from Zion, when he will rule from Zion. Well, this passage is a description of the promised blessings given to the people of God, to Israel, who walk in the fear of the Lord. But what happens when I don't fear the Lord? I mean, my fear of God, it fluctuates from day to day. Should I not expect to be blessed by God? Well, this is where the new covenant shines so brightly, because for us, the blessings of the fear of the Lord are in a person, because Jesus feared the Lord. Jesus feared the Lord. Jesus receives the blessings of the fear of the Lord, and I am in him and he is in me, and therefore I receive the promises and blessings. Paul says it this way in 2 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 20. He says, "For all the promises of God find their yes in him." Jesus feared the Lord perfectly. And therefore, the promises given for those who fear the Lord are in him. They're in a person. And we too receive the blessings and the promises that are given to Jesus. Now, as we slowly start to land the plane here, I know that some of you come here today and you're like, "Brian, I mean, really? My home is a wreck. My work is a wreck. My family's a wreck. It's not going well with me, Brian. I'm not blessed, but I fear God. I fear God. I fear God, Brian. And yeah, it's not perfect, but I don't see the blessings in this passage. How am I supposed to join in this song?" Remember, this is a song that the people of Israel would sing. And three times a year, they would sing this song. And yet, they would look at their own lives and say, "I don't see this blessing in my life. How are we to sing this song when we're going through great times of suffering, when we don't see the blessings that are described here, that are promised here in this passage? How are we supposed to sing it with integrity, with joy?" Well, first, we have to let these promises stand. We have to let what is said here be said. I mean, fruitful labor, happiness, a fruitful house, these are all truly blessings. But these are what I might call, what we might call ordinary blessings. I kind of struggle with how to say this part. I really want you guys to listen carefully to this part. These are what we might call ordinary blessings. I thought about using the word standard, the standard blessings for those who fear the Lord. Fruitful work, a happy, fruitful family, church that is blessed. But there are ordinary ways that God blesses us, and there are extraordinary ways that God blesses us. So for some who fear the Lord, they receive maybe not the ordinary blessings that's described here, but they're receiving an extraordinary blessing. We might even call it supernatural blessings. Now, if you're struggling today and you're saying, "Brian, really? Supernatural blessing? Extraordinary? I don't feel that way at all. Again, my house is a wreck. Things are not going well with me. My job is not going well with me right now. Extraordinary blessing?" Well, I say that because that's what God's word says about those kinds of blessings. for those who fear the Lord. I want to give you two examples, two men who feared the Lord, but they didn't experience what we read about in this passage. But they did experience blessing. It was supernatural blessing. It was extraordinary blessing. First is Job. The reason why I choose Job is because in the very first verse of Job chapter 1, verse 1, we read, "There was a man in the land of Uz whose name was Job. And that man was blameless and upright, one who feared God and turned away from evil." Job was a great guy. He was upright, he was blameless, he feared God. And yet right after that, we know the story. His children are stripped from him. The fruit of his labor is destroyed. His health is taken away. And only his wife is left with him, and she's far from the fruitful vine that we read about in this passage. She says, "Curse God and die." How does Job sing this song in a situation like that? And his buddies come along, and they effectively say, "The reason that all this bad is happening to you is because you don't fear God." Is that the truth about Job? Is that the truth about you? And yet that's often right where we go when things are bad happening. What did I do wrong, God? What did I do wrong? Right when we face difficulty, what did I do, God? What did I do wrong? Look at Job. 42 chapters in which he wrestles with this. God, I fear you, I love you, and yet everything has been taken. But God had to change his way of thinking. God has to change our way of thinking to see blessing, not just in the ordinary blessings that we read in Psalm 128, but the kind of blessings that come through suffering, the kind of blessings that draw us closer to God. I mean, think about it. When have you been closest to God in your life? Is it when things were going well? Or is it when you're going through suffering and the loss of those things? Amen? The point is, for those who fear the Lord, God blesses you either way. Sufferings and hardships in family and work, sometimes they are, let's face it, the consequence for our own sin, right? But that's not always the case. Look at Job. What about Job? Well, now you might say, "Wait a second, Brian. Job was given back everything at the end of his life, though, right? He was given even more than what he had at first, right?" Okay. What about Jesus? No one feared God more than Jesus. No man was more blessed than Jesus. And yet no one suffered more than Jesus. He too would sing this song 3 times a year. He would sing this song, "Your wife shall be a fruitful vine." I don't know how the song goes. I wish I knew how to sing it. "Your wife shall be a fruitful vine. Your children shall be like olive shoots." He's singing this song knowing, "I'm never going to have a wife. I'm never going to have children. Things are not going to go well with me on this earth." But he looked forward to a greater blessing, a supernatural blessing. It was the joy that was set before him that he endured the cross. The blessing that would come from that. And no one was more blessed than Jesus. I mean, you want to talk about fruit from your labor. How about the salvation for the sin of the world? How about the conquering of Satan? How about a family of brothers and sisters? No one was blessed more than Jesus. And yet Jesus suffered all the way to the end of his life. He died on a cross at the end of his life. Paul describes a fellowship of the sufferings of Christ. And some of you, when I say those words, you know exactly what I mean. When you're suffering, and yet God is blessing you at the same time. Because you have a sweeter, deeper intimacy with God in the midst of your suffering. And so if you're suffering and you don't see these things in your life, maybe it's for a season, maybe it's for a lifetime, but could it be that God's calling you not just to the ordinary blessings, but to the extraordinary blessings, to supernatural blessings in your life? God's blessings come to us in different ways. Sometimes they come ordinarily, sometimes they come supernaturally, but either way, for those who fear the Lord, we have a fearfully blessed life. Amen? Let's pray. God, we thank you that the blessings that we all long for in life, they come from you and they come in a person. We can never earn them. And it's not based on our performance. We thank you that we don't no longer have to be terrified of you because you have taken our punishment on the cross for our sins. God, I just want to pray for anybody here this morning, Lord, who maybe they're not experiencing these blessings in their life. Maybe they don't feel blessed by you. Oh, God, would you show them that they are blessed? Would you show them that you are taking them into a deeper and more glorious and more beautiful experience of your glory and your presence in their life? Help them to embrace that. In Jesus' name we pray.